Welcome back to the DBS News World, and thank you so much for staying with us. A male security guard stationed at a prominent resort has been severely beaten. The security guard was located at the outer perimeter of the resort when a young man approached and was attempting to access the property's water fountain. The security officer in question advised against it and was verbally abused by the young man, who also threatened him. The security guard, who had a canine with him, released the dog, and a chase for the intruder ensued towards the edge of the perimeter of the hotel. The man later returned to the location with his brother, armed with a cutlass, and were both threatening the security officer again. He attempted to retreat when both men started throwing stones at him. One of the stones hit him in the back of the neck as he ran. This caused him to fall face first onto the concrete walkway, where he sustained severe injuries to his face. He's reported to have been later found by landscaping technicians in an unconscious state and was taken to main security outpost before being transported to the Victoria Hospital for treatment, where he was admitted for observation and underwent a CT scan as well as chest and face x-rays. The incident occurred on Monday at about 2 p.m. He has since been released from hospital and is recovering at home. Combating cybercrime and a Commonwealth roadshow among schools on the island are among the activities lined up as the British High Commission's office in St. Lucia gets set to take part in a Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting. Here is Don Nicholas with more.
The United Kingdom is working with the Commonwealth Secretariat to ensure that the Commonwealth Heads of Government Conference is a success. Matters down for discussion include policy issues such as marine protection in an effort to make sure the sea is used as a sustainable resource for growth. Modern slavery and cybercrime are also down for consideration.
On cybercrime, there is an intention that leaders will talk about how to deal with cybercrime and possibly come to a declaration, which is an agreement between all the Commonwealth leaders to deal with the issue of cybercrime.
During the week of the conference, there will be a number of forums, namely women, business, youth, and people's forums. St. Lucia will be well represented at the women's forum.
I'm pleased to say that on today, International Women's Day, I had a meeting with some of St. Lucia's influential ladies today, and St. Lucia will be well represented at the women's forum in particular, with Foreign Minister Sarah Flood Bowburn in attendance and other people from St. Lucia also in attendance.
In terms of activities in St. Lucia, the British High Commission's office will be engaging in a Commonwealth Road Show among schools that begins on Monday, March 12th. The conference, said to be the largest of its kind, will be held in London on April 16th to 20th. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Boys Training Center was today the recipient of a refrigerator, compliments of Courts Unicommon. We hear more from Sheffield Gillard.
According to the center's assistant manager, the donation could not have come at a better time. Samantha Orlier says that the refrigerator is one of many appliances needed at the facility in the rehabilitation of its wards.
The greatest challenge for us is human resource. Human resource as well as physical resources in terms of items such as the fridge and also stove. There's a need that we have an increased need for a lot of things at the center, and I'm hoping that other corporate sponsors will come on board and assist the center as we try to rehabilitate the young men. We try to reintegrate them into the society. The fridge basically will be used for two main aspects. One is our cooking. We want to provide them that opportunity where they will get hands-on skills and training in terms of cooking basic meals. And the other is for our sporting activities.
Courts Unicommon is no stranger to the BTC, as it has in the past refurbished rooms at the facility and made several other donations.
It is very important for business places like Courts to play their part in the communities in which they serve. So whenever we do have the opportunity, it's always our pleasure to do so, and we encourage other corporate citizens to do the same.
The refrigerator is valued at $2,500. The presentation took place at Courts Mega Store at Marisil. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
And now this. An opposition MP has described as shameful and an insult to the people of the South plans by the United Workers Party administration to construct a new hospital in that part of St. Lucia. This is a clear indication that the government does not plan to complete a structure which reportedly does not meet certain standards. The original St. Jude Hospital was gutted by fire in September of 2009. Since then, its operations have been transferred to the George Odlum Stadium. Don Nicholas tells us more.
Plans for reconstruction of a brand new St. Jude Hospital are in its advanced stage. That's according to Economic Development Minister Guy Joseph. The minister spoke of plans to reconstruct a new hospital within close proximity of the existing structure.
I can tell you clearly the government is more bent towards just building a new facility. It may be adjacent to the existing facility, or it may be closer to the brewery. But in one of these areas, very close to the existing St. Jude, is we are settling on building a new facility that can incorporate some of the facilities of the existing buildings that are there.
SLP spokesman on investment Dr. Ernest Heller admits that both parties are to be held accountable for the fact that after 9 years, since the old St. Jude's was destroyed by fire, the new hospital is yet to open its doors. Dr. Hiller says the UWP government failed to deliver on a promise to complete the hospital within 100 days.
But to suggest that, you know, the Labour Party failed miserably and the UWP is such a success, it's been 2 years and St. Jude cannot finish. More so, the United Workers Party promised St. Lucians that they would complete it within 100 days and whatever else they said.
Just recently, the SLP held a march in the south of the island to protest against the delayed opening of the facility. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The SLP is seeking an explanation. We'll tell you what that's all about in just a moment. Welcome back to the broadcast. The opposition St. Lucia Labour Party's Dr. Ernest Hilaire is seeking some explanations from the government regarding the provision of health care services.
This is your methodology or your modality.
SLP spokesman on investment Dr. Ernest Hilaire has quoted the government as saying that it cannot afford universal health care. According to Dr. Hilaire, the UHC concept was introduced by the SLP government, and it is internationally understood that under this arrangement, all citizens will receive adequate health care. However, in the same breath, according to the SLP spokesman, government is indicating that it wants all St. Lucians to access health care. This statement, according to him, is either confusing or political.
This is either confusing or it is political, and let me explain. It might be political for the simple fact that the government does not want to say they're implementing universal health care because it was a concept introduced by the Labour Party, an aspiration introduced by the Labour Party.
According to Dr. Hilaire, government promised to introduce health care insurance, which in his view still amounts to financing UHC.
This is your methodology or your modality for financing universal healthcare, because there are different ways in which you can finance universal healthcare. You can finance it through direct taxation by, say, you're going to increase the VAT from, well, now it's 12.5%, bring it up to 15%, and the money is used for that. You can do it through NIC contributions. Everybody who pays NIC would pay it, and government would pay for persons who don't pay NIC.
Insurance, Dr. Hiller says, seems to be the preferred option in this case. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other news, the Constitution Park earlier today hosted yet another activity to mark International Women's Day. It was covered by Alex Bosque.
The St. Joseph's Convent and a cadre of female entrepreneurs seized the day, showcasing their products, displaying the entrepreneurship of local women. Last year, the teachers and students of the school celebrated the market vendors in observance of International Women's Day.
People were still excited about the whole idea, and we felt it was necessary that we continue the celebration, knowing that we are an all-girls school. So we wanted to bring about that awareness and to encourage the students. We looked at this year entrepreneurship, and so that people know that they can create the change that they want, they can create jobs. And we realize that the Department of Gender Relations had the same idea, so we joined together with them to make this a realization.
The St. Lucia Industrial and Small Business Association found the day fitting to push forward their members in an attempt to showcase their craft, the first time for many of them.
SLISBA is St. Lucia Industrial and Small Business Association. A lot of our members are business women, rural business women. So it's our opportunity. We're taking advantage of International Women's Day to push our members forward. So that's why SLISBA has teamed up with all of these other feminist organizations to help push the business women of St. Lucia to bring forth what they do on a daily basis that people don't normally get to see. SLISBA do a lot of hand-holding for some of our members because they have the business idea, but then they don't have the support, whether it's financially or even as in getting them registered, taking them to the different steps of getting your business registered, getting your business out in the public, advertising, doing business plans, helping them financially, because we even do give assistance to our members.
It's International Women's Day, so we are celebrating women, entrepreneur women in business, creative women in business. Well, I am the creative director and manager of the Zip Code, where all accessories are made from zippers. We use nylon zippers and metal zippers. All our creations are, well, some I got from Pinterest because that's where I got the idea, but I've been developing my own designs over the past couple months, and it's been a rewarding experience.
Today I'm here to display my things again, and also because of International Women's Day. I want persons to see that as a young woman I can use my creation to do things to share with the other young persons.
I think it's very good. I think everybody should be made aware of the things that women are capable of doing and achieving. And this just goes to show how much women can achieve. I love it.
For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
We'll have more news on today's observance of International Women's Day later in the broadcast. Teachers at the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School have industrial action on their mind to protest several health and safety concerns. Their bargaining representative, the St. Lucia Teachers Union, has pleaded with the authorities to undertake the necessary improvements.
According to information reaching DBS Newsworld, the issues facing the school have been brought to the attention of the Ministry of Education as far back as 2007 without any sort of redress. There are reports of serious leaks which have led to huge buildup of mildew, mold, cracks in the building and electrical issues.
The teachers continue to come to school, working tirelessly under those conditions. But we must remember they are human beings. They are human beings. So yesterday, the union had to engage its members at Castries Comprehensive to hear from them what their tolerance level is like as it relates to the conditions they work under. At present, they are not occupying their current staff room. The staff room had to be refurbished, and there were some health and safety issues as it relates to fumes from the road and the dust coming in from the road area into the staff room. They were actually in direct contact with the fumes and the dust from the road, and the room had to be sealed off and air-conditioned so that they can operate in there comfortably. Unfortunately, that has not been forthcoming.
The teachers are currently operating from the school's Learning Resource Center, and while Mr. Howell says the SLTU is grateful for the remedial works currently being undertaken on the roof of the building, water is seeping into electrical wires and outlets.
And that water seepage is causing mold in the LRC. So really, they have no place to function. So the SLTU has written to the Ministry of Education, a mandate given to us from our members that within 72 hours, the ministry must give us a definitive response as to when they are addressing the issues at Castries Compre. The SLTU is dealing with this as a strict industrial relations matter at this point.
The SLTU is urging the ministry to come up with a long-term solution to these issues as the students' education is at stake.
The issues have been dealt with in a piecemeal manner. So, for instance, a section of the building where there's leaking, they go and they try to cover it in a piecemeal manner. But within a short space of time, the problem resurfaces. That's what has been happening at Castries Compre. Castries Compre, hence, it needs a holistic review, a holistic assessment. And we know that that has been done. What is preventing the authorities from implementing or coming up with or enacting the solutions for Castries Compre is beyond the SLTU. All we know is that our members cannot continue to operate under such conditions.
The learning institution has approximately 60 teachers. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues.
Good evening. Welcome to the DBS Sports. I am Kenson Casimir. We begin tonight with local football. Fair CDC were briefly on top of the SLFA Division 1 Cup. The team from Central Castries defeated RV Juniors in the first clash on the night at the Ansari playing field. Talented midfielder Jonathan Simforian found the back of the net for VSADC in the second half of this encounter. As a result, VSADC were 3 points clear of the other title contenders who were in battle at the Philip Master Grounds. Well, later on, Platinum FC went back on top of the 2018 SLFA Division 1 Cup. A team from Beaufort defeated Big Players on Wednesday night. In this top of the table clash, the Emmanuel Bellas coach team defeated the team from Masha 2-0 at the Philip Master Grounds. Well, the team from the capital of Castries were also down to 10 men in this matchup. National midfielder Gregson President was on the score sheet for the team from down south. This result puts Platinum level on points with VSADC. However, Platinum has an amazing goal difference of +7. Platinum will play against bottom of the table RV Juniors for the title next Wednesday. Well, the first match scheduled between Uptown Rebels and Tiroche FC was called off. Meanwhile, defending champions Northern United will be officially dethroned in this year's SLFA Division 1 Cup. A team from Groseley had to come from behind to register a draw against Alers on Wednesday night. In a match played at the Ansari playing field, Northern United were pushed to the limit as the game ended 1-1. Funil Montoute found the back of the net for Alers in the 6th minute. Prolific striker Randolph Peltier was the saviour for Northern United in the 85th minute. The results mean that Northern United will finish no greater than third in this year's tournament, and they have to win the next game to do that. As for Alers, the team sitting currently in the relegation zone still has a chance to stay in this league. A win against Tiroche FC in their final game and defeat for Tiroche against Uptown Rebels may see the Ansari team featuring in next year's tournament. Well, victory was recorded for Sir Alpha Lewis Community College over Lyonhurst Comprehensive as the 2018 Massey United Insurance under 19 secondary schools, well, schools cricket tournament continued. On Wednesday, March 7th at the Darren Sammy Cricket Grounds, Sir Alpha Lewis, after winning the toss and batted first, made 326 for 9 in their allotted 50 overs with a maiden century for former Lyonhurst student Brant Jean. Jean, in his debut match for Sir Alpha Lewis, batted wonderfully, making a brilliant 112 not out with 12 fours and 4 sixes. Other useful scores came from Jad Goodman, of course, with 36, Stephen Mitchell, 30, Dean Edward again, 29, Domenico Gies, 28, and Raheem Joseph on 15. Well, bowling for Lyonhurst Comprehensive, Keegan Arnold, he took a 4 for 48 in 10 overs, and one wicket each was taken by Carlos Felix, Terrell Dennis, Udo Preville, and Jaden Eli Box. Hawks. In reply, despite a beautiful century from Captain Keegan Arnold, Lioness Comprehensive fell short of victory by 112 runs as they were dismissed for 214 in 40.3 overs. Arnold, the 2017 Windward Islands under 15 captain, batted with relative ease in stroking 112, which included 11 fours and 4 sixes. Other main contributors to the total were Benaya Monzi with 16 and Judo Preville and Mateo Bolong with 15 each. For South Louis, the wickets were taken by Charles Sipal with 4 for 44 in 8.3 overs. Dean Edwards, 3 for 28 in 7 overs, and 1 wicket each for Dudley Charles and Raheem Joseph. Wow. Well, the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports hosted their inter-schools track and field qualifiers earlier today at the Darren Sammy Cricket Grounds. The schools participated. They included schools from the north, including Groseley Secondary, Corum Secondary, Barbuno Secondary, Boys Training Center, BTC, Castries Comprehensive Secondary School, Sir Ira Simmons Secondary, St. Mary's College, Vidbutai Secondary, Entrepot Secondary, St. Joseph's Convent, Leonhurst Comprehensive, Bokas Secondary, Cicero Secondary, and Sir Arthur Lewis Community College. The event is also expected to continue tomorrow, Friday, March 9th, 2018, at the Darren Sammy Cricket Grounds. Well, we take a break, but when we get back, West Indies registers another victory, and we'll look at some of our successful women in sports. Welcome back. An aggressive knock from West Indies captain Jason Holder ensured victory for the regional side in the second World Cup qualifier on Thursday in a match played at Harare. Papua New Guinea, who won the toss and elected to bat, were bowled out for 242.4 overs. A Valor top scored with 57 from 89 balls. For West Indies, Carlos Braffett was outstanding with the ball. The medium pacer bagged 5 for 27 in his allotment of 10 overs. Nikita Miller was also good with the ball as he grabbed 2 for 25 in 6 overs. Well, in response, West Indies got to their desired total with an outstanding knock from captain Jason Holder. Holder hit a magnificent 99 not out from 101 deliveries, falling one run short of a well-deserved century. Shea Hope was injured in the first match. He held the innings together. Hope made a patient 49 not out from 115 balls. As a result, West Indies won by 6 wickets to sit comfortably at the top of their group. Part-time off-spinner Austin Chase had a century maker Sam Hain caught in the deep with 3 balls left as West Indies ace snatched a dramatic 5-run victory in the opening day night one day of the 3-match series against England Lions on Tuesday night, chasing a competitive 273 at Coolidge.
Time now for the usual reminder. The Speaker of the House of Assembly has resigned. Police disallowed the use of placards during a march to observe International Women's Day. A security guard is beaten at one of the island's leading resorts by a member of the public. And the Boys Trading Center receives a refreshing donation. And that's the DBS News World. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the broadcast. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian, wishing you a very good evening. Coming up at 8:30 tonight, right here on DBS Television, Talk with Rick Wayne. Goodbye.